Our presenter is from ISRO. He is Dr. B.N. Suresh, who is a Vikram Sarabhai Distinguished Professor, and he'll be presenting the role of space exploration in nation building in this session. A very brief introduction on our speaker. Padma Shri Dr. B.N. Suresh obtained his master's degree from IIT Chennai and doctorate from Salford University, United Kingdom, under the Commonwealth Scholarship. Joining the Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, he ultimately became its director. He founded the Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology at Thiruvananthapuram. He is the recipient of Dr. Biren Roy Space Science Design Award from the Aeronautical Society of India, the ASI Award and the Aryabhatta Award from the Aeronautic Society of India, the Outstanding Achievement Award from the Department of Space, the Lifetime Contribution Award from the Indian National Academy of Engineering, and the National Systems Gold Medal from the Systems Society of India. He was selected to chair the prestigious UN Scientific and Technical Committee for the year 2006 by the Asia-Pacific countries. Ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed an honor and a privilege to have him here with us. I'd like to request all of you to please give him a very big round of applause as we welcome him to the session, Dr. B.N. Suresh. I'd like to request Mr. P.S. Ravindranath to please welcome Dr. B.N. Suresh to this conference. So on behalf of the organizing committee, we'd like to welcome you to this session.
Good morning. Let me thank the organizers for giving me this excellent opportunity to highlight what space has done for nation building. As all of you know that space activity started somewhere in the middle 60s, and Vikram Sarabhai has been the founding father for the space program, and the first ever tiny rocket, a tiny Nike Apache, an American rocket, we launched from the shores of Tumba on 21st November 1963, that was the beginning. It was a sleepy village near Thiruvananthapuram, that's where we started the space activity. But then in the last 4 to 4.5 decades, we have really moved forward and made an impact in terms of meeting the national requirements. While being in the government and sort of achieve the success, I'm sure that the project management has played a very major role. And this being the project management conference, I would like to touch upon here and there how really we have steered ourselves to achieve success in everything that we have done. And it's very comfortable to me because the inaugural speaker, Dr. Abdul Kalam, he was one of the important functionaries in the beginning. And in fact, I had the privilege of working with him for almost 17 years. And what is important is the question often asked is that the space is very expensive business. How do you really sort of work in that area and at the same time serve the common man? And this is the question often asked, and we need to get an answer. And I want to tell you that I have about 30, 33 slides, and I promise to complete within 50, 55 minutes. So that you don't get frightened that I will go on talking for long. And at the end, I have a very interesting video, which is quite exciting. You know, for having worked in the space arena, launching a satellite is something very exciting. And when I say launching the satellite at Sriharikota, the entire ISRO is focusing on the launching. You have the launch vehicle, you have the spacecraft, you have the operations people, the launch base, the entire 16,000 workforce of ISRO, they work in tandem. I think yesterday Dr. Kalam made it a point that we work like a team to achieve the success. It's like a symphony orchestra, and no single instrument player can lose the rhythm. If he or she does that, the entire music is gone. That is the difference between the success and failure, and what goes in achieving this success is something extremely important. Now, you know, why space can serve this society? How it can help the mankind? You know, that is the important question that we must face. And also yesterday Kalam mentioned that we have a few visionaries in this country. To Dr. Vikram Saurabhai, to visualize that space is going to give the solutions to the common man in early 60s, and also the what you see there in the green box, we must be second to none in the applications of advanced technologies to the problems of man and society. He made this statement when he dedicated Tumba Equatorial Rocket Launching Station, we call TERLS for short, at Thiruvananthapuram, and this was the statement made by him. Because we all joined, you know, for example, I joined in 1969, and it was extremely difficult for us for at least a decade to face a common man and then convince that person why you are working in that high technology area where we have so many problems in the country. How are you going to solve the problem? But then, you see, to visualize that space has a unique ability to provide the synoptic view of the earth. You know, I was in one of the conferences somewhere in Europe, and one particular session was only by astronauts. And that astronaut, one of the astronauts, while talking, he sort of presented a video, very interesting. And everybody who has gone to space, and he or she was in the space for a couple of days or even months, when they come back, they take a view that the earth is a fragile element sitting in the universe. You know, we keep fighting between nations for resources, for many things. But once you go and get a synoptic view of the earth without any geographical boundaries, then you think that it is such a fragile element. How do we protect it? How do we take care of that? How do we protect ourselves? You know, this is something one has to do. So having said that, it has an immense potential to tackle many of our problems. Society faces problems. And also, how do we really improve the socio-economic conditions of the human being on this earth? What are the problems we are facing? Let us take today. I think all of us know that the natural resources are being exploited indiscriminately, whichever country, wherever you go. And of course, that also gives rise to several other problems what we are, all of us are aware of as on today. And also, you can see that the greedy of the human being is such that the depletion is much faster than their recuperative limits. You know, we are not able to get it. I think that's why yesterday again Dr. Kalam stressed, how do we really find energy which is going to vanish very soon? What are the alternate ways of doing it? Communication to foreign difficult terrains. In fact, space is one which has revolutionized. Today, if we are able to talk, taking our mobile, and then across any part of the globe, I think you must thank space that has done a tremendous job in connecting people. And also, you see, of late, the weather, global warming, the surface temperature increase, the rain variation, weather anomalies, all these things, do we have a solution? And ultimately, how do we really maintain the balance between the fragile nature and environment? And also, you know that there are many droughts, natural disasters happening, whether space can play a role. These are the areas, and as I go along, I would like to just highlight some of the samples of what we have done. You know, being a case study, we should tell you that what Indian space has done in some of these areas. You know, one can go on talking for long. Now, when it comes to the Space for national development, I already mentioned, it was the visionary Sarabhai mentioned. But then, what we have done is, we have adhered to his dictum of meeting the needs of the common man and structured the application program. You know, in space, there are three segments. One is the application program, when I say, in terms of getting the applications from remote sensing, from communications, and then various problems I mentioned, listed earlier, how do we get solution? This is the application part. Having said that, how do we really implement it? You need to have a spacecraft which is there in the sky at appropriate location which you have defined, and it should have its own payloads or instrumentation which in turn would give the applications that you are looking for. And the important thing is, how do we put it in the orbit, in the precise orbit, that is a vehicle. So you have the space vehicle, you have the spacecraft, and you have the payloads through which you derive the application. We are interested only in the application portion, ultimately. These two are only the elements which would assist us in doing the application. So you can see that we planned our whole program by structuring the application program, and of course, we have developed our own necessary infrastructure. And we concentrated on four important areas, as I mentioned earlier: communications, remote sensing, meteorology navigation, disaster management. Of course, there are quite a few other areas one can look into that. And of course, we planned our whole program accordingly. And I must say, at this point of time, while it was Vikram Sarabhai who really visualized how the space program should go, I think yesterday Dr. Kalam also mentioned, the entire project management structure is given by none other than Professor Satish Dhawan, who was the director of Indian Institute of Space Science, and he was holding concurrently the director of Indian Institute of Science and chairman Indian Space Research. We were very fortunate to have a person like him. And I can tell you, the project management structure, what he has set up somewhere in the 70s, even today it stands. We have not departed, excepting do the minor corrections here and there. It has stood the test of time. Maybe if you are interested, we can spend time when we come for the interaction. Okay? Now, what is that we have done in the last four decades? So this so-called, the structure that you have provided, we are able to do. You know, we have had 34 launches, and we have launched 61 satellite missions using our own soil and as well as the procured launches, and out of which 26 foreign satellites we have launched hitherto using our own from Sriharikota. Okay, as I said, you can see that there are in an ellipse in the center, you have the launcher, that is the vehicle. Inside, what you see, they are the communications team of satellites. IRS is the remote sensing spacecraft, and as on today, we have 21 operational satellites. I think this is the biggest in this part of the globe. If you compare the entire, the services that are available from space, biggest assets that we have. And another thing, what you see on the left, extreme bottom, end-to-end capability. You see, if you are waiting for someone to launch, or if you are waiting someone to provide the satellite for your application, you would not go anywhere. You need to develop that end-to-end capability. That is, you are 100% self-sufficient. You know, this is what, in fact, Sarabhai stressed, and Indian Space Program has done it very effectively. Now, I told you the frontal phase is the application. What are the common man needs? How would you meet it? You know, take your food and water security, looking at the weather and climate, environment, education and healthcare, skill development. I think, you know, the previous speaker talked quite a bit on skill development and employability, rural communication, infrastructure development, disaster management, smart convergence, sustainable development. You know, development has no meaning unless you make it a sustainable development. Then, of course, strategic application, that is the last one. And in each of them, Indian Space Program has left its footprints in each one of them. And some of the samples I would like to give. You know, coming to the applications, one is remote sensing. These are the spacecraft which are at low Earth orbit, anywhere between 500 to 1,000 kilometers. They are in the sun synchronous orbit. and they are able to survey the natural resources of the country. And you can see that in this curve, whatever you see on the plot board, 1972, we started launching our own Aryabhata using Russian vehicle, and since then we have come long way. On the top, in the arrow, what you see, they are all remote sensing, and in the bottom, what you see, they are all communication spacecraft. And I told you already, we have launched 62 spacecraft of this kind, and today we have 21, they are available as assets. Of course, you know, that whatever is written in blue, they are all the technologies, I don't think they are relevant, but then you can see what goes on in making such a satellite, make it operational, make it work. You know, that is something all of us have to really think about it. This shows, in fact, a category of Earth observation satellites, and don't worry about the cluster, but what is important is, see the bottom line. You define the payloads which would meet the application needs, like high resolution imageries, you want to take the photographs for surveying the resources, for strategic application, for whatever reason. I will show you just one picture. You have to make the ocean observation, which has a direct relevance to understanding the resources in the ocean, the weather monitoring, many things. Land and water observation. I think I will give some examples. Then, of course, the meteorological observation. I talked to you about weather. You can see that we have the thematic satellites built to meet the specific needs of the country, and accordingly, the entire thing has been structured. You say that this is the application, and these are the payloads, this is the spacecraft, this is the weight of the spacecraft, this is the orbit that I need to have, and this is the launcher I will use for launching, precisely in that orbit. You know, it's all well-structured, well-planned program. A proper planning, proper management, proper project implementation goes in all of this. Now, you see, when you talk about the surveying, how do we observe the Earth, with what resolution? You can see that in your extreme light on top, 1 kilometer, and since then there is a dotted arrow, what you can see, it has improved, and today we have reached almost world standards where our resolution is sub-meter, less than 1 meter, which means you can see if the window is open in a building, you can see that window is open. If a person is moving in a particular area, you can track that person is moving at this point and after some time where it is. And you see, interestingly, I have brought just one. I think our SBI Air would have talked much more on this because he was working in this particular area. You see, today we have the capability to completely map the entire globe, and particularly India, in three-dimensional. And just what you see is, this is taken from one of our satellite, where you have different cameras at different resolutions. You combine them and create. They are the real ones which are taken in one of the areas in India, actually. This map is available for the entire India, anywhere to anywhere today, actually. Just to give a flavor of that, okay? Now, just to give an idea of what the spacecraft will look like, and I will not get into that because it's yet another area, but it's a very complex technology. And this is the one what I have brought here. You know, it's used for, you can written there, application potential for cadastral level mapping, urban and rural infrastructure, for information system, many things. You know, this was launched on January 10. And what you see there is a camera. It's a very, very sophisticated instrument in terms of lens, in terms of mechanical engineering, in terms of application. And you can see that the spacecraft is under testing. It gets integrated with the vehicle. I will show you as I go along. I mentioned that, you know, we can take pictures. This is just, those who are familiar with our bus stand in this city, immediately you would recognize. You know, like this, we have hundreds of thousands, and you tell any portion, we can get the photograph. You know, when there is a cyclone, when there is a flood, immediately they come to us, they ask the pictures to be taken, we are able to provide how much really has submerged. You know, there are many, many solutions. Now, for what various things we can do? One is, you know, applications, I said observations, Earth observations. I said this fragile, you need to preserve it. So you can sort of survey the land use, land mapping, land planning. You can worry about forest, environment, biodiversity. You can worry about weather and climate. You can worry about water resources, how do you manage? This is another area where it's getting depleted very fast. In fact, one of the important areas that we need to worry, disaster management and support. How do we really avoid disaster? If it happens, how do we really manage, give a better management? Then, of course, I already mentioned ocean mapping and resources. You know, like this, one can go on and on. This is just to give a flair of what we have done. Now, let me cover a few applications. You see, all of us know that forestry is important for any country. Your weather pattern, your water availability, then yes, the erosion of the land, many things, they are dependent on the forest. In fact, I must say that ISRO has done a commendable job in, we have the advantage of taking the picture of a same area again and again and again at the same time. I can tell today it is 10%, tomorrow it is 15% or 8%. See, for a healthy nation, it is told, I was told that it is somewhere around 20% is, 17 to 20% is a very healthy forestry should be there. But then the greed of the man has taken us to a different place, because that is the one very easily you can earn money. And so we were able to sort of advise, we have also interacted with several agencies, government agencies, NGOs, the private operators. So for all that, we have a different mechanisms to manage, coordination committees, the items with which you can interact with different agencies. This is one which is done for Kerala. And I was there in Kerala for long, and we used to have a lot of data, and I was personally interested in that. You can see that this gives the completely the cover, forest cover assessment, biodiversity, the biological richness. And what you see on the right, we are able to distinguish between various requirements with respect to forest. You can really see which plantation, whether it's increasing, whether it's decreasing, what needs to be done. And I think because of the intervention of the space, I was again informed that the decline of the forest, what was happening in the country, they are able to reverse the trend. The state government, they have taken it in the real spirit, and they are able to sort of get back. It has touched almost some places 11%, 10%, and I think there is a reversal trend. Now it has improved 12, 13, 14. You see, this is how you help the country. This is how we are able to help the nation, actually. This is just one application. Similarly, wasteland. Ours is a very vast country, as all of us know, actually. So we are able to sort of make an inventory of the wasteland. You can see that there are different projects which are going on, and also the scale, you can see 1:50,000 scale it was done. Not only that, the picture, that color what you see on the Indian map, we are able to categorize into wasteland, what kind of wasteland it is, whether it's a dry, whether it's a wet, whether it's a cultivable, whether it can be utilized, which can be utilized. This kind of, one sample I have shown in the box there, you can see that, how we are able to improve the wasteland, which was 60 in a particular area, and over a period, and you can see how the percentage has been brought down. These things very difficult for any single person to assess, unless you are in a strategic place, you are able to get that kind of data and analyze and make sense out of that and feed that information to appropriate authorities. So these are the things that is being done by space. Now, I also mentioned about climate and agriculture. You see, what is important is we have focused on sustainable agriculture. I think I have one slide subsequent to that. Then, of course, we are talking about the Himalayan ecosystem. The picture on your left top, that lines what you see, that is the line how your glaciers are receding. I think the Space Department has generated this data and able to provide. In fact, this data has entered into, discussions from all over the globe. In fact, this was one of the very hot topics. I think you might have seen that. So these are the areas we are able to make our own assessment. And water mission, how do we really assess the resources, flood damage, how are you able to control? A host of activities one can do and then utilize this. All these, what you see in this slide, they are all sort of slated towards climate and agriculture. Suffice to say that so much more data has been generated, so much more interaction with the concerned agencies are there, and each of the areas people are utilizing these services. We will not get into the details of how you do it, why you do it, okay? That one can possibly discuss separately. You know, this is a very interesting slide, and I don't know how many of you know that the Space Department, in association with the Agricultural Department, we are able to assess this, the agriculture production in terms of wheat, in terms of rice, in terms of how we do it. You can see that, you know, there are four pictures I have written there. First estimates, second estimate, third estimate, final estimate. In fact, what you do is on the right side of on your plot board, you know, these are the informations we use. It's a considerable amount of work. People are well trained, the experts are available. There are not only the technologists, there are scientists involved in each of this. You know, geologists, the physics people, chemistry people, biologists, all are part of the whole thing when they generate this kind of data. And I want to tell you that this prediction is given much ahead to the government of India to say that you are able to meet your targets, or you will have an excess, or you will have a shortfall. What does it mean to the planners? If there is a real shortfall and you give a projection, I'm sure the planners can plan accordingly to import or to preserve. You know, you can really see that you don't get into a difficult situation. This kind of data is available. They are made. In fact, I would say that the accuracy with which our prediction and when the real output comes, they have compared, and they are all within 4 to 5% error band. That is reasonably good. You know, this is what is happening with respect to various things. This is the last slide as far as the application is concerned. I don't want to go on and on, because just to give you a flavor, you know, this is one of the important projects. This got award, several awards it got. It's called Sujala. Basically what is done is, how do we improve the degraded watersheds to make it productive? Also in the process, generate the employment. In the process, bring out poverty elevation. You see, basically it is slated to improve quality of life, to generate more assets of natural resources, empowerment of the vulnerable, increase the productivity, and also support the livelihood. You know, at the same time, we have brought, you know, there are very many social scientists involved in that. Not only scientists and technologists, very many social scientists are part of this. You can see the integration of the several disciplines. And if you have to make it successful, it's not an easy task. And you have to do it in time, you have to make it cost effective, and at the same time, you should generate the needed advantage to the common man. You can see that project profile is there, and you can see that the implementation is done through Watershed Department, Government of Karnataka. We got the funding from World Bank in addition to other things. Of course, the Antariksh Corporation, ISRO, they were the monitoring agency. You know, they were, apart from the various other units and centers of ISRO, we were all involved in that. And see, this particular thing has been done by self-help groups, area groups, NGOs, Gram Panchayat, different officials, about 38 taluks of Karnataka state. You know, I have shown a sample of them. If you put all 38, it gets clustered, you get lost. And you can see the participation. And the entire thing has, the training has been done through our own satellite, you know, SATCOM, and we were able to empower the entire, educate them, and the beaming is in the local languages so that they understand, they appreciate, the questions are asked, you know, like that it goes. Now, you know, this is a very drawn affair, about almost maybe 1 or 2 years, and then it has really given very good dividends. What really happened, this is one of the real case study, I must say, wherein we were able to demonstrate. In fact, this component has increased quite a bit. You see, quality of life improved, and household income in that particular region, whatever 38 taluks, increased by 30%, cropping intensity increased, crop yield increased, improved crop diversity. You know, for example, you have 2 to 5 crops, depending on what crop you grow. We were able to advise them, change the crop, have more crops. Instead of 2, you can make 3. Or instead of 4, you make it 3. You know, all these advices we were able to give. It generated employment. a fairly good employment, because you know you need people to come and support and work. And migration, because of this, people who are from this region, they don't need to go and search job elsewhere. You are able to create jobs where they are. You know, this is, these are the important factors one must consider. Wastelands, I think, you know, this is where you are able to say almost 50 to 60% reclaimed. You find the wasteland, you analyze and understand chemically what it means, then you see which crop to grow and advise them accordingly. And water availability also is taken into account. And of course, because of this, the additional advantage, livestock, milk production, and groundwater level yield increased by 250 gallons per hour. Because they created the nice, you know, you didn't allow the rainwater to be wasted. All this, the advices were given. This is the power of space, actually. Only if you put it very effectively, I think you can derive maximum advantage. Now, I think that's as far as the survey, one can go on and on. I think there are several areas, but then the shortage of time does not allow me. Maybe one can possibly spend some time in understanding things. Now, this comes the communication spacecraft. You see, remote sensing spacecrafts are positioned in the sun synchronous orbit anywhere between 500 to 1,000 kilometers, basically circular orbits, whereas the communication satellites are placed at approximately 36,000 across the equator, you know, because then the movement of the satellite synchronizes with the speed of the earth. As far as the satellites are concerned, they are considered as the stationary, okay? Here also you can see that we have started with a very low weight. Today we have almost touched 3.3, 3.4 tons. And of course, launch capability is concerned, we launch. Today we don't have the capability in India. We are trying to achieve that. But I think very shortly we would reach that particular requirement. Now, what are the applications? Broadcast, you know, television broadcast, direct to home, TV and radio networking, and I mentioned meteorological imaging, data collection, disaster warning, communication, and other, you know, like mobile satellite services, search and rescue. We are going in a big way on the satellite navigation. So that is going to give a great amount of benefit to the common man. And of course, India is unique in having our own program for education, for medicine, like telehealth, tele-education, emergency communications. You know, today, if one has to understand the contribution of space for the country, the space potential, the French European Space Agency president, I was in one of the international conferences. He made a very interesting statement. I think I liked it. I would like to repeat that. It's not original. He said that if any country today who have such strong space assets, if they switch off their satellites, entire space satellites for one day, the country, everybody will catch cold and fever. In other sense, you know, today we have 21 space assets. I tell you, entire Doordarshan, the entire telephone network in some form or other, the private TV channels, the banking sector, the share market sector, several, they are all linked to our satellites today. And if we indeed switch off all satellites for one day, all of you would feel the pinch of it in some form or other, I can tell you. So that is the real benefit that one can derive. And what is that we have done in this communication area? I would like to give a few examples, okay? Now, you know that you can't launch communication satellite as you feel like, because it's a global asset. You can put only in the 36,000 kilometers orbit along the equator, and there are several countries in the globe, and you can't simply go and put your vehicle wherever you like, what we do in cities in our vehicles. It has to be put at a very specified location, which is agreed internationally. There is a forum where they meet, they agree. In fact, you know what you see here, that the ellipse, what you see, 48, 55, 74, 90, 83, 90. These are the five slots allotted to the India. In fact, we have to position our communication satellite only in this particular slot. You can't simply launch it and go and put somewhere else. No, you can't do that. It is very precisely how to locate it there. And another condition they have put, if you don't put your satellite for a certain period in the allotted space, you lose it. You know, they're all very well linked. These are all international criteria which have been laid down, and we are all party to that. And so today, that itself, you know, India has done very, very efficiently putting two satellites, three satellites. The distance then between them becomes very small, and it's not easy to maintain because they are going around in very high velocities, continuous basis. There is a drift coming. Still, you are able to maintain its position. In fact, in order to see that they are maintained, there are facilities established like HASAN, Master Control Facility, and recently we added one at Bhopal. Their job is precisely to the health of the satellite and see that they are all positioned in its own slot. You know, this is very important. And the entire sector I mentioned, Doordarshan or banking or television channels, ultimately it's all one can convert into number of transponders that you have in the sky. And we have around today, you know, unfortunately we got a setback in the last 2 years. Some launches failed, and we are somewhere around 160, whereas our requirement is beyond 400, 500 actually. That is the kind of demand nation has placed on us. So we have to increase the capacity, and the one that diagram, whatever is shown, roughly gives who is using what. You know, what is the government share, what is private, what is orbit spare, how much BSNL uses, DD how much use. You know, that gives, and in fact, there's an old slide. I'm sure that one has to do an update on this, okay? Now, what are the societal services? The tele-education, we are the only country to, of course, apart from having our own communication satellite and transponders available, you can use it. But then we had our own thematic satellite called EduSat we launched. And that satellite is used essentially for education purposes. In fact, you can see that as on today, we have more than 55,000 virtual classrooms. In fact, there is a demand to increase, but we have the limitation of transponders available in the sky. In fact, we, you know, we have to meet their demand. We still have difficulty. Of course, the other three are how we really developed that program in the initial stages, like Jabuwa, Gramsat. But you can see that you have a satellite, then it is connected to school or higher secondary, and you have a hub at a known place, and you can link it. You can have a single-way communication, you can have a two-way communication, you can transmit the pictures, you can transmit the audio in almost real time. You can do that. You know, this is the biggest advantage. In fact, it's possible. You know, I happened to give a talk in Amrita University. You may be knowing, in the deep south. They have in Bangalore, Coimbatore, and somewhere near Koilan, and they are all well connected. In fact, when they called me for talk, they linked it, the whole thing. And in fact, every other place was damn full. And interaction, real time, you are able to interact with all three centers. You know, that is the power actually. And education today, you know, this serves as a very powerful tool for a country like ours. Same thing with the telemedicine, principle remains same. And in fact, you know, today, something like 382 hospitals are linked, and 59 are specialty hospitals. Even a place like Andaman and Nicobar, they are linked with very good hospitals in Chennai, Bangalore, or elsewhere. And even when we had this pilgrimage center, what is that pilgrimage center? That Shabarimala. You know, there we linked it, we put a terminal last, because the number is increasing, and suddenly they feel, you know, giddiness or pain and things like that. No medical facility, you can't serve it. So we linked it with that, with these important hospitals in Cochin, Madras, and they were able to give the services. In fact, there are several case studies one can present on how people have been helped, cured. Many times people feel that they have a heart pain and I need to be operated, or, you know, there would not be anything, it could be a simple thing. But then how do we really discuss and communicate? There are several cases where you have told them not to do anything, where you have told them to rush immediately to one of the specialist hospitals. So lives can be saved. You know, this is something which has happened over a period, and there is a very big demand. And this is something unique that India only has done, what we call village resource center. What is needed is, you know, you can see on the left top, for the villagers, they need information. I think yesterday Dr. Kalam told that we have entered into an era of information. You know, it is the information era really. But what they need, you must know. In the language they need to know, you should know. And you should uplink and link it through the satellite to different places. You can have very many. You know, Dr. Swaminathan, he did a pioneering job in the Tirunelveli area. He is Swaminathan Foundation. He is the person who helped us, who sort of made it as a case study, and it was a roaring success. They can get weather, they can get information on the, you know, the market rates of various things, the weather prediction, many, many things which they know. So this is what we call single window outlet, where any information I need, you get it almost on real time. One important thing is that we provide the facilities. It's like you can take horse up to the water, but drinking has to be done by horse. I don't think you can drink. It's of no use really. So that is where we need to build our efforts and see that the services that are provided, they are available in large number, and we are able to do that, okay? See, what is written is advisory related to agriculture, fisheries, natural resource information, skill development. You know, there are very many people in the remote places, they can develop the skills, tertiary skills. You can make them develop that skill and utilize that for your own benefit, or the benefit of telehealth, tele-education. And at the same time, you know, once you have a network like that, you can have access to education through our tele-education network. You can have access to medicine through our telemedicine. You see the advantages that we can derive. And in spite of space being there for more than 5 decades all over the globe, I think we are quite happy that we are able to reach the common man through these kinds of efforts. And thanks to Sarabhai, who set the guideline that you must do it for the common man. You know, that is never forgotten in ISRO. Of course, another thing is disaster management. You can see that flood management, cyclone warning. You know what you see, you would have seen in television. The eye forms, it becomes very sharp, keeps moving. Then you can tell when it's going to hit, where it's going to hit. It's a continuously changing environment. It may happen, may not happen. Today, I think we have established, particularly on the East Coast, you know, from Chennai up to West Bengal or up to beyond that, we are able to predict and then evacuate people. Otherwise, a lot of disaster will happen. Similarly, the landslides, you can tell for sure what is happening. There are several areas, and we also can monitor the drought and tell in advance what is going to happen. You know, these are all being utilized, okay? Of course, how it is done is, you know, these are all the, again, you can see that it's not just a single person or single entity or single agency who can do this. These are multiple agencies. The designers, the users, the application people, and the instrument that you employ. You see, observation satellite. You have the satellite, you must have an aerial survey, and what you see as a, you know, dome-shaped building is the weather radars. We have implemented in several places, they are there today, and that number is increasing. Continuously, we are able to monitor that data and feed into the system. So we are able to predict. And in order to give the quick support, you can see that second one, single window for services. You don't need to go to or run post to pillar. A single agency gets all this data, they analyze, they deliver the ultimate goods that one looks for, okay? Now, you ask me really how vulnerable we are. And I don't know how many of you know, we are the most vulnerable country as far as the disaster is concerned. Not in terms of one, in terms of several, whether you call earthquake, floods, and also it's a very strange country. You know, one side you have a huge flood, another side you have a drought. And there are several things. You can see it's all, we have mapped based on the data available, geological data, and classified them, and they are all available as a big map available for the users. In fact, anyone wants to know detail, they can get the data. You know, they are all available in terms of geohazards, in terms of hydromechanical, and you can read that. They are all quite self-explanatory, okay? Now, I think that completes the satellite and application. I have come to the last one or two slides. You know, to launch, the first one what you see, this is the one what Dr. Kalam was mentioning. He was the project director. SLV, and you can see that it was capable of carrying 40 kilogram spacecraft into orbit. And today, with our PSLV and GSLV, if I take an equivalent orbit of LEO is low Earth orbit, okay, what you see right in the bottom, I can put 5 to 6 tons in the equivalent orbit. Whereas we launched in 1979, which failed, 40 kilograms. And the next one was the augmented ASLV, what you see there. And the third one is the Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle. You know, we have launched 19 of them so far, excepting the first one, all of them are successful. This itself is something very creditable. And it can position anywhere now between 1.6 to 1.8 tons, the remote sensing spacecraft. Of course, it is a versatile vehicle also. The GSLV is the geosynchronous, which is used for communication, but it has a capability up to 2.5 tons. So in order to meet the demand of 3.5, what you see, Mark 3 is under development. We are hoping that we should be able to launch in a couple of years, this Mark 3. And once we develop that, we become 100% self-reliant. And also at the same time, I want to tell you that it's not just ISRO alone. It is the entire country, I must say, in terms of industries, in terms of academia, in terms of R&D departments and other departments, we have an excellent synergy between ourselves. And I don't think we claim that we have done it. It is in collaboration. But then we were instrumental in getting it done. You know, that's where the management factor comes. One can talk on that at great detail. Okay, this is just to show that, you know, these are the two workhorses we call, okay? 19 launches we had, and PSLV, excepting one, all are, that has done several missions. It can do low Earth orbit, it can do sun synchronous orbit, it has also launched communication satellites. You know, GTO is geo transfer orbit, and on your right side is GSLV, geosynchronous. This is at low Earth orbit now, it can carry around 5 tons, and you can see the capability, okay? Now, I want to give just a flavor of 2 or 3 areas where, how we have contributed other than our own technologies for, you know, what you see here, the polyurethane, what we developed for our own aerospace application, and there was one Mahavir Vikalanga Sahayat Samiti, they approached us, we worked with them, we created, in fact, this has been completely implemented, transferred the technology without any fee, and today it is being used at several places, and it's very light actually. This is one thing which has gone from our own development. And the second is denture material. You know, this is also again another what we call composite material, what is written as PMMA. It is developed for a particular application. But then the people from the industries, they came, they found out that this material can be used. And today again, this has been very effectively implemented for dentures. Not only implemented, it is durable and cost effective. You know, this is another advantage. Of course, this is the another important in the electronic area. I think many of you heard that for search and rescue all over the globe, ships are used and you use the beacons. And they're all very expensive. So in fact, we work based on that. We made it a very cost effective, less than, you know, 10,000 is when we developed. But if you put it in large production, I'm sure it will come down even much lower. The government of Kerala, they found that this is very useful for, because lot of fishermen, they go around in Kerala, both in Cochin, Trivandrum, north, you know, for fishing, and suddenly the weather will change. So in order to know where they are, in order to track them, in order to suppose something indeed happens, you can send an SOS team very quickly. So they wanted to productionize Keltron. It's one of the establishments in Kerala. They have taken the production, and they have agreed, the fisheries minister agreed that they are going to implement it. You can see that. You know, there are several. This is just to give you one flavor I have done. Now comes to the interesting portion. You know, this is really not part of the lecture I should give, but then I think this should excite all Indians. And I have participated in almost all launches from the day one till today in some capacity or other. And, you know, you must participate in the launch to really get the feel. I just want to give you the flavor and what kind of technology that goes. You know, that's what I would like to highlight. This is, you know, what you see is the launch range. And this is the one what you see. is the tower. This is around 85 meters tall. This is where we launch the, we start stacking the vehicle. You can see that. It's a gigantic, you can see that. And this is the base where your launch, you will start the pedestal. On that, you will start the, and what you see here, it is 2.8 meters diameter. Solid propellant, you sort of put them in segments, okay? Segment after segment, you assemble. You see now, then you bring the strap-on stages, and you can see that they are sort of being assembled. And you can see the size of the vehicle compared to the people who are there. Now you see, this is what we call the last, and this is the second stage. You can see, you know, there are more than 240 bolts with 240 holes. They have to match precisely. Even a few microns variation in that, it will not get in and you can't put the bolts. I'm sure that you would appreciate that. You know, you can see the size. This is the second stage. What you see is the, you know, third and fourth stages. They are assembled and they are getting integrated. You know, what you see on the top, there's a titanium tank where the propellants are stored. Again, these are all done by industries. What you see here is the satellite. You know, I told you one of the satellites being prepared. It gets prepared in the lab, and this is solar panel deployment. You see, it comes with the strings because you want to simulate that zero gravity, okay? So that you make sure, and after that they give artificial sunlight, okay, to see how much power it generates. You have an estimation and you are able to do that. You can see that, and you can see it's done in a very clean environment. That's why the people have that kind of costume, okay? And now the satellite is brought. It's sort of moved to the, she was the deputy project director from satellite center. The satellite is already mated. And now there are two parts of the heat shield. Black one you see on the other side. You know, this is another satellite. Now those two halves, they come and then completely cover this. You see, that's what you are seeing. This is essentially to see that when it goes through the atmosphere, your satellite is not burned. Otherwise, you don't require that. It gets separated actually. Now the vehicle is ready, assembled, tested. Okay, people are doing the last minute operation. And you know, it's ready to leave its house now. It's going to move about 1.5 kilometers on a rail track. It is kept on a pedestal. That itself weighs pedestal around 400 tons. And vehicle will be now, because propellants are not loaded. Otherwise it weighs around 300 tons, maybe around 150 tons. You know, it moves, you can see the rail. It has to come to its launch tower. It's another gigantic system. You can see this is the one. It is again 75 meters tall, okay? And the vehicle looks pygmy now because the tower is so large. Otherwise, this is 54 meters tall. Otherwise, 17 stories tall building, you know, when the vehicle is assembled. And when the vehicle is assembled, these are various countries. There are hundreds of computers connected. You know, this is the one Dr. Kalam came. I've taken this picture because he's going to say something in the end. You can see that, you know, how the symphony is working now.
Minus 35 seconds. Minus 30 seconds.
Onboard computers in flight mode.
Real-time program activated.
Minus 25 seconds. Minus 20 seconds. 15.
Ignition enabled.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
In the plot board, can you see there is a red line? That is one what you predict in terms of altitude and in terms of velocity. And the one, the blink what you see is coming from the telemetry RF signal. And as long as it embraces that red line, you know, various operations are going on. And You see, you can see that blink and the red line. Can you see? It's on the board. This is where that the heat shield gets separated. And once you launch, till the satellite is separated, you have absolutely no control. Everything must work as you have planned. If anything goes wrong, that mission is separated. You end up with wasting national exchequer to the tune of 300 to 350 crores. That is the kind of money we are talking in terms of technologies. You see, these are the various events. It comes on the platform, like separation, the ignition, and these kinds of things. It has almost reached the satellite separation.
Yes, Kakos has been separated successfully.
As you can see.
Separated. And now both the satellites built by ISRO are launched on IRA, on the ninth launch of the PSLV, PSLV C6, have been successfully injected into the orbit.
Chairman, Indian Space Research Organization, Mr. Madhav Nair, and all friends, and day and night, you are all working here. So I congratulate all of you for an excellent performance of PSLV 6 and the Cortosat 1 and the Hamsat satellite, all in good performance. I was watching. So I was very proud of you. The country is proud of you. Wish you all the best. And you know, I still remember in 18th July, when I was in the other control center, then we 40 kg we launched in the low Earth orbit. Today, you have launched after nearly 25 years, 4,000 kg equivalent to 1.6 ton in the polar launch orbit. So my hearty congratulations, for India is proud of you.
Okay, that's just to give you a flavor, okay? Now, I think this simply summarizes that in the last four decades, I think we are able to really fulfill the ambition of Vikram Sarabhai. And as I mentioned, you know, these are all due to well-structured management programs, the way in which the projects, you know, every activity is projectized. Every activity has a project management. In fact, you know, I was asked to come and give a talk in NASA. That's where I met Raj Kaladi at Houston. What are the real project management techniques that you are using which really make it tick? You know, that was the theme really. It's very interesting, and we don't climb any, some benefit out of that, but then it's all Satish Dhawan's vision, and he really structured an excellent system. You have a concurrent, the organizational structure, you have a concurrent project management, the people who are in the project, accepting what we call core team who run the project, very small segment of 15-20 people in all gigantic projects. All other people, they come from the various entities. They work on development and was one leg, have another leg in the running the project. Now this has really paid dividends because they own it. What they deliver, they have to own it. And at the same time, they are answerable to the success of the project. So how it has been done, how the reviews have been structured, how we are able to sort of keep track of everything, you know, that is something very interesting. And being a government department and able to sort of meet the requirements of the country, and at the same time working in the cutting edge technology where the difference between success and failure is very, very thin. You know, you are seeing launch. Even if a solder is bad, even if a wire is having a fault, if one bolt is having a defect, that mission will be a failure. The failure, what it means is 250 to 300 crores to the national exchequer. And this is happening all over the globe. And it's our responsibility to see that we run the management so effectively we don't get into the failures. But then certain things, because these are all strategic, we don't get any information, we don't get any item from anyone, everything we have to do ourselves, but then it has taught us a great deal lesson. So thank you very much for your kind attention. Okay, if you have any specific questions, yes, please.
Hello, good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, sir. My name is Parikshit Bharadwaj. I'm from Mindtree. I have a two-part question. One is, what about the manned mission status? How is the manned rating of the GSLV Mark III coming along? And my second question is, how is the RLV, the reusable launch vehicle, and when can we see a first flight of that vehicle?
Your third question is on RLV? Okay. You know, human space mission, I think we worked on the project report and we are really looking forward. But unfortunately, we faced two GSLV failures, which all of you are aware, very recently. And I think, again, it becomes our primary responsibility to set right those problems and bring back GSLV on rail, because, you know, the transponder requirement for the country is in real demand, and we are fully concentrating on that. So we are just waiting for this thing even to happen, and hopefully by middle of next year, we should be able to put back GSLV on rail. Now, Mark III is progressing quite well, and the exact date of launch, I really do not know, but then they are working hard. In a couple of years, they must see that it goes successfully. Reusable launch vehicle, essentially, you know, all over the world people are working, because the cost of launch of a spacecraft is very, very prohibitive. All over the globe, today it costs to put 1 kg of any payload into the orbit, it costs around $10,000 to $15,000. And I think you would have heard by Dr. Kalam, again, he stresses on the energy and sun energy, how to utilize. Space can play a very dominant role of utilizing the sun energy, where, you know, you can put a big solar array which can absorb and then collect the data and then send it. How to send it is an issue. But all that will become sort of possible if only you bring down the cost of launching. So reusable launch vehicle assists in doing that. So there is an experimental plan which is being worked at Vikram Sarabhai Space Center. And I think they must be launching pretty soon. I again don't know the exact date and all that, but they are working on that.
Hello, sir.
Question? Sir, you thank you very much for...
No, I'm not able to hear you at all.
Thank you very much for the introduction. It was an eye-opener for me, at least. I stay very next to ISRO office, but I didn't know that you do all these things. But I'm surprised that you didn't refer about Chandrayaan, which was another fantastic mission that you launched. We discovered...
You know, my focus is not to show what ISRO has done. My focus is, I've been asked to talk how space has helped for national development. I have structured my entire presentation to tell you what contribution we have done for national development. Chandrayaan, I can't say for sure today that it contributes to the national development. Mm-hmm. It's again like, you know, we created a station in Antarctica. You need to show your presence there. Otherwise, from now to another 10 years, you may lose your grip on the whole scenario. And we have done it very cost effectively. But I don't think I can bring Chandrayaan and claim today that I have contributed for the national level. This is just, and the amount that we spent on Chandrayaan project is a very, very small segment of our entire budget, really. And incidentally, I want to tell you, I didn't mention that our expenditure on the space program in India is 3% of USA's and about 12% of ESA and about 33% of China's. You know, that is the budget on which we have been working.
In fact, that's what makes this Chandrayaan mission so fantastic. You discovered traces of water molecules on moon, which others couldn't. So what is this project all about? I mean,
ultimately, it is the instruments that you provide. And in this, two instruments were there. One is the Moon Mineralogy Mapper from Jet Propulsion Laboratory of US. They are our partners. And second, there's again a combination payload where Switzerland, our Vikram Sarabhai Space Physics Laboratory, and avionics, they three worked, another instrument.
Okay.
I forgot the name. there you sort of provide the measurement so that, you know, when it sees the trace of the water, it gives a very large signal. So you should get it, analyze it, and make a synthesize and get the sense out of that and present it in some of the peer-reviewed journals and make it accept. The moment they accept, that's a reality. That's what has happened actually. And today, you know, is one of the biggest achievements. And we don't say again that we did it fully. You know, again, ISRO is never claims that we did it. I think it's again huge collaboration, not only nationally, internationally also. Chandrayaan, from the project management point of view, maybe you should hear to another. He talks quite well. How he managed not only nationally, but about six instruments from six different countries, and all of them have to work in synergy and work together. You know, that itself is another. The standards are different. The project management style is different. Each country has a difference of their own. Right. But you have to bring the synergy between these countries and still make it work.
Right. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, sir. So I'm from Arogya Shri Healthcare Trust, Government of Andhra Pradesh. We provide healthcare services to more than 2 crore population who are below poverty line. So we provide this healthcare through a network of hospitals which are connected through internet to our data center. But the challenges that we are facing in this context is that we are not able to connect to the primary healthcare centers which are in the remotest areas of Andhra Pradesh or the tribal areas. We are on the verge of using mobile technologies to connect PHCs. So, but here in this context, I would like to ask you as to how we can connect these PHCs and where the internet availability is not there.
Are you referring to the last mile connectivity?
Yes, sir. Like we have AP statewide area network, but still they have not reached the remotest areas and they have not found the last miles there.
No, I'm just not able to get it. What is it? For your question, answer is available. There are VSAT operators who are available. You can link it. Only you need to ask that facility for you. It's possible to do it. Okay. These are all absolutely no problem. In fact, that's what I said, you know, many times the information dissemination is not proper. If you really seek what you want and try to contact the concerned authorities in ISRO, I think they would help you without any problem. They are all easily doable.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, in the short line of eyesight that I have, I see only erosion of lakes and trees being cut down, all these levels that are coming down, natural resources which are all coming down on a day-by-day basis. I do not have the vision of the satellite, but as a common man, and I see, this is what I see on a regular basis happening. So where is the thing that is missing with the people who are supposed to, you know, stop all this?
No. What is the action? I'm not able to hear you properly. Can you repeat the question? Can you repeat? Just tell.
All the resources, natural resources, coming down on a year-on-year basis. In Bangalore, when I see across my area, all the lakes are being going down, the water levels are coming down, the greenery is all coming down. Year on year, it's just going down and down. So we have all the satellites and the advancements of satellites that you mentioned, which can be used to prevent this. So,
yeah. You know, that is a very valid question. That's what I, you know, used one sentence of, we are the service providers, but we are not the service users. That's where we interact with the government agencies, NGOs. In fact, the government, the concerned departments, for example, I don't know who deals with these kinds of things in the government of Karnataka, they have to come out with a plan, interact with us, get the data from us. We are willing to interact with them. You know, several projects which have done based only on that. But we don't have the resources to do everything that what you can think of. We are always, you know, behind meeting the requirements of the satellite, meeting the requirements of launch, application program, analyzing, collecting the data, analyzing the data, putting in the database. But how to take it, how to utilize, I think people have to come forward. So what is missing today? You know, this is the question asked everywhere, including parliament asked the same question, thinking that ISRO has the solution for all the ailments of the country. No, we can't do that. We are only very small segment in a 1.2 billion population in the country. And I think it is for, that's where we keep telling in every available opportunity what we can do, what data is available. And if you are interested, we can hold your hand, we can tell you how to do it, we can educate you and see that it happens. In fact, that village resource center, what you have created, essentially is that, so that we are able to, you know, information dissemination happens and they are able to take it, utilize it for various purposes. And that's certainly possible. Yeah.
Hello, sir, there is a small question. You showed that satellite image, that image processing, is it possible to go much, you know, detail level? My question on that is like, you know, there were two incidents where India was searching for the chief ministers were missing. So, you know, there are a lot of exciting research you have shown that, you know, that image processing, you know, is possible. Is it, you know, the technology where we can bridge the gap so that this kind of situation, you know, emergency comes, where the nation can get the help from ISRO?
No, as far as the image processing is concerned, I think not only ISRO, I think there are several agencies who are extremely good at it. Your image enhancement, everything is possible. But the incident that you mentioned, you know, if it is a very thick forest and a human being somewhere hidden in that, the satellite has no way of identifying a person whether he is there or not. You know, that is the problem. It's not the, you know, one time it was told whether you can find someone hidden somewhere. How can you do that? It's extremely impossible. So, but if you are able to visualize and get the image where it can show the traces, then we can get the image, we can do the announcement, we can identify, and we can help. It's a question of getting the information. That's all.
So, one question here is, in last 45 years, we have made a lot of progress in space exploration and also in satellite communication. Moving forward, in next, say, about two decades, 20 years, we need to accelerate that and be on the cutting edge. Do you see ISRO or government collaborating with private sector coming into it and providing services, doing things quicker, faster, with ISRO and giving us better technology and products in space?
No, ISRO has been collaborating with private agencies in everything that they do. But you know, there are mechanisms which have been established through which one has to come and make use of that mechanism and interact. And I also agree with you, you know, these are the areas where a lot more has to be done with the kind of technology explosion which is happening. It's very difficult to predict from now to another 5 years how it will look like. You know, it's beyond anybody's imagination to forecast what it would be, and that's where we need to join hands. The private, the government agencies, and even I would say academic institutions, industries, I think all four have to get together and then see how we can do that. It's possible, and we have established mechanism for each one of them.
Sir, so, I would like to first thank you. You know, it was a great eye opener. You know, like another friend of ours said. Again, I do not understand all of those terminology and the technology that you explained. What I want to know is there technology available, or are we working on something which can be used for national protection as well, which can be used for maybe detecting bombs the moment they are made, for example?
Yeah, you know, the common answer given is, if you can see from there, you can see everything. I told you, know, that's why I made use of the word, a door is open in your window, you can see that. That gives the answer for you. But you know, ISRO's program, as stipulated by the government of India, is 100% civilian operation. So, you know, I'm constrained to give any further details on that. But this first answer of, that's why I made a statement deliberately, that even if a window door is open, that projection, whatever is there, you can see. That's where your resolution matters. Today we have such a fine resolution. I think almost equivalent to any other country today.
Excuse me.
Hello.
Can you give some idea about the difference in level of competency in space development program or the technologies used in space development by India and USA or developed country? Which are the area where we lag and what is our status?
This is again another interesting question. You know, Sarabhai, when he laid down the principles for us to work, he said, don't ever compare yourself with anyone. You sort of look what you should do for the country and do it. As long as you keep doing, I think that's adequate. In other words, honestly, we are not really looking to compete with anyone. We are not even looking at what other countries have done. In fact, our entire program is dictated by what country needs, what the requirements coming from the government, coming from various agencies, you know, that which folds into our system. We take that input. In fact, the Planning Commission provides that kind of data and we work on that. If you ask me frankly, where do I stand? You know, I have spent my 42 years in launch vehicle development. Where do I stand with respect to launch vehicle development in China? I have absolutely no clue. But if you ask me whether we can meet, accepting beyond 2.5 tons communication satellite, I don't have the capability today. We are concentrating on that and see how we can meet that. You know, that's one reason it has become, it is able to meet the needs of the country and it has become cost effective. If you get into the race of competition, that day you lose your supremacy on the technology, supremacy on the entire thing that what you are doing. You know, it's very focused. And I think in that respect, we are very lucky to have a person like Sarabhai who gave that dictum in the very beginning. And you know, I spent 2 years with him when I joined in the very beginning.
Sir.
Hello. Hello. Yeah. I have a question.
I have a question. Like, it's every country is trying to send satellites and get it done, but what is the project management for scavenging the debris out there, which has been cluttered for like some...
You know, it has become a very difficult task today that there are several procedures that have been adopted. One is you cannot retain any spacecraft which has lost its lifetime, okay? So then you need to sort of bring it to the earth. The moment it enters into the earth, you know, it burns and then no more it will survive. Or you have to lift it by saving certain fuel to the graveyard orbit. It's called graveyard orbit. You know, if it is between, I said 800 to 1000, somewhere beyond 2500 kilometers, they have defined a grave orbit, you push it and leave it there. It will remain for centuries there actually. Similarly, the all spent final ultimate stage which injects the satellite goes into the orbit. So you need to sort of deplete all the propulsion and make sure that they are all entering into the earth in a very regularized manner over a period. There are very many stipulations which have been brought out by the international forum. You know, this is discussed at the UN Committee for Peaceful Use of Outer Space, UN COPOS at Vienna. In fact, they hold three sessions in a year, one in February on science and technology, and one in June on legal aspects, and one, the combination of these two somewhere in the June, two weeks, you know, altogether 1.5 months they spend. All countries are signatories to that. And there we debate, discuss, and accept all these issues. But what we are not yet able to solve is, you might have heard that China destroyed one satellite some time back, and US destroyed, and these are all, you know, very difficult to contain them actually. That's what is being discussed in UN forum. We try to bring regulation, but powerful countries, if they do, what do you do really? We have no answer. You know, that self-discipline is very important.
Excuse me. I want to ask one question about the GPS system. Came to know that in the US defense is operating that satellites, I hope in six satellites in four orbits like that. None other than that, no other country is doing it. And also I came to know that they are offering it free of cost for all countries. Regarding this, can you throw some light on that, whether is it true and ISRO is in way linked with that?
No, no. See, as far as the GPS is concerned, what you said is true. United States of America, they have the GPS. Russia, they have GLONASS. And Europeans, you know, they have Galileo. In fact, like that, if you take the entire band of the universe, there are gaps. In fact, China is working on that. But we have come out with an innovative idea of not, you know, if you want to have entire global coverage, you need to have that four satellites in, or six satellites in four orbit, or four satellites in orbit, somewhere intermediary, so that you get 100% coverage. But then we are thinking of having our own scheme where you have seven satellites, which gives the full coverage for India. Then the second aspect you mentioned, they allow free usage of GPS. But when you use it for your own purposes under strategic conditions, at that time they choke. In the sense they will switch off. So the, if you are depending on GPS for certain important tasks, and if it is off at that time, it's like cutting off the oxygen to a human being. You know, that's what really happens. That's why all countries, they try to do on their own. But GPS has tremendous potential in terms of surveying everything on the earth, actually.
Is there time for one more question?
Yeah.
So my question is from the project management perspective. I don't want to be rude, but I really don't know whether in ISRO you have active project management practices, in the sense you make a huge plan of many years. Do you find out the critical path? Do you have crashing? Do you? We don't get that information because you all are so...
No, no, I told you, you know, the focus in this talk is I should first tell you what we have done. Then only I can talk about project management, number one. Number two was tell you how we have contributed for the national development. That was the theme.
Right.
But then, as I've been telling time and again, nothing comes for free.
Sure.
Really, if we have done it successfully in this short span, I'm sure that there must be a proper project management practices. In fact, I told you, I gave a lecture on our ISRO's project management practices at NASA. They invited me, really. What all you said, how you have structured yourself, how you take care of the, you know, the if there is a crisis, how you manage it, what is the kind of risk that you take, risk management, how you do, and how you have structured your project, what is your hierarchy of the structure that you have in terms of organizations, in terms of projects, and how they are interlinked. And I told you, you know, for example, when we launch the satellite, the entire ISRO is behind that. This entire 16,000 industries, they are all part of that. And you would have seen in the video how so many people, you know, sitting on the terminal, they look at it and then say yes or no. And for all that, there are well-led procedures, linking, and the management structure. You know, for example, you take launch. There is a mission director. Mission director is one single person responsible for the entire launch operation for that particular launch. Not even chairman ISRO, not even center directors. There is a mission director. He is the supreme authority. If he says stop it, it will be stopped. If he says you go, it will be good. Only thing is he may sort of ask consultancy by a few experts. Again, they are identified. Not that he can run post to pillar to find if some problem comes during the launch operation and stops. Then he knows where is the problem, whether it's in electronics or propulsion or mechanical. There are a band of experts available on the spot. Immediately they are summoned, they discuss, and then go ahead. Similarly, there is one for the vehicle director. There is one for the satellites, satellite director. There is one for the range operation. There is one for the tracking satellite. So this really forms the core group of the launch management. Like this, you know, project, if I take, there is a project director. You know, you take about satellite project, I should. There is a satellite project director. Then project director is assisted by a number of deputy directors in each of the area, because our technology is multidisciplinary. You know, you have avionics one, propulsion another, mechanical yet another, mechanism yet another. So they in turn have to work out how to really tie these things together. And there is yet another called configuration management. You know, the system keeps on changing.
Right.
How you really keep track of that? We go even to the extent of how you track the material. You know, the material which goes in, I told you, if there is a one defect bolt, you lose the mission. How do you get that particular bolt? How do you, from who is the source of supply? Even if there is a change in source of supply, you worry how to qualify it. you know, there are hosts of other things. Maybe I can give a talk at some other time later, okay?
Thank you.
In the interest of time, I'm afraid we'll have to bring to an end this session. Ladies and gentlemen, please give Dr. Suresh a very big round of applause. That was a very interesting presentation. It's quite unfair to try and crunch that kind of experience into an hour and a half, but I think he's done that justice. So if you could please come on stage, I'd like to request Mr. P.S. Ravindranath to present Dr. Suresh with a small token of our appreciation, as we thank you, sir, for having accepted our invitation. And thank you very much indeed for being a part of the conference. Thank you very much indeed.